want of a better expression, we were separated for 6.5 years. We were actually in court. We'd been granted the divorce nisi. With just one court hearing to go, that would have granted the divorce absolute.
What happened? I mean, where did you lose it? You guys were all... How long did you date for?
About 5 years.
Dated for 5 years, and then got married eventually. Finally, dating is over. He's mine, she's mine. And then after how many years did it happen?
Pretty much immediately.
Immediately? Wow.
Yeah, I think that was a rude awakening, because I think to a large extent, couples tend to be besotted with one another. They are swept off their feet. They are completely overwhelmed with what is happening. And I think to a large extent, because love is a dominant factor, the couple seem to think that will conquer all. That's all they need. And it's only when reality gives them a very, very stiff uppercut that they realize that there's a lot more to life, there's a lot more to relationships, there's certainly a lot more to marriage than love. And it's when, in our case, certainly when...
Your realities now.
Our reality.
Yeah, what were those realities you talked about?
I think the biggest misstep, if I... can put it that way, on my part, was leaning on one's own strength, on one's own experience, thinking that look, I've been around the block for quite a while. I was I'm quite a bit older than Funke. There's a 9-year, 4-month age gap, and I felt, you know, I'm world-wise. I've done a thing or two, and to a large extent, Funke should be dancing to my step. Mm-hmm. And I should be like, you know, the man on the dance floor. I should be the one dictating things. But again, that was where things started going awry. And it's only later on, with the benefit of hindsight, that one realizes the importance of putting God first, of looking at the foundation on which one is standing, and realizing that if God does not constitute that foundation, then whatever that foundation is definitely shaky. And the slightest headwind, the slightest atmospheric interference, then everything starts falling to pieces. And that's precisely what we experienced.
All right. Funke, you want to break it down? He spoke in broad strokes. You want to get that pencil and sharpen it and just start scribbling a thing or two? Specific stuff. What happened? You guys dated for 5 years. Nice and sweet. Finally got married. Then, boom, almost immediately. What happened?
I think the realities hit us.
What realities? Realities that you were not compatible, the economic reality. What? For 5 years.
It's different when you're dating someone. Mm-hmm. You get to go home, you get to do other things, you have other friends, lives, and all of that. And then coming together as a married couple, you're in your face 24/7. If, like in our case, I didn't start work immediately. My husband went off to work, he would come home. So there were certain expectations, and some of them on my part were unrealistic. And I would say those were the initial issues, and how I communicated that to my husband, what the issues were. So they were really about me relying on my husband to make me happy, him being the being my everything, my whole world sort of revolved around him.
And possibly because he was much older than
you.
Yes,
so I looked up to him for everything, basically.
So would you say that was wrong?
No, it wasn't wrong, but I think it was... the expectations were unrealistic because we're wired differently, men and women. Mm. So I think it's unfair to look to one individual and expect that one individual to make you happy, to meet all your needs. And I had to you know, after the 6 year, you 6.5 years apart and all of that, you know, like you started off in your intro, you did say that, you know, life forces you to stop, look and listen. And that, I think that was what happened. You know, at the onset, I didn't pause. I just went straight into the marriage, and I had expectation this was how it was going to be. We're going to live happily ever after. I didn't think about the in-betweens. What will happen? How will I contribute towards making him happy, or making, you know, towards our own happiness? And I just expected things to just happen. So I think it's important that we're deliberate, you know.
Was that pressure on you? You know, her expectations of you, was that pressure point? Would you say it put pressure on you?
Definitely. And I think listening to Funke, in the same way that her own expectations of me were not realistic, I think the expectations I had of myself also were extremely unrealistic.
Okay, and pause there. What were you expecting? Just one or two things.
To love me, that's not a bad thing.
But for him,
and to show it to me in ways that I could understand, and to put me before family, I wanted to be first place, and I didn't feel that. And for a woman, it's important that we feel that, we know that, we hear that, we're affirmed, things like that. So I would say those were the expectations, but because I didn't, I would just sulk. Rather than communicate those things to him, to talk about them, you know. So those were the things really that caused conflict. It was how the lack of communication.
There was no communication.
There was no.
And you probably thought you were doing your thing, as in showing her love. But showing it in your own way, I suppose.
I did, as far as that was the problem, because as Funke said, she was not. From her own eyes, I was probably putting other people first. Sometimes family, sometimes friends, and for me, that was the last thing on my mind. I couldn't understand who she was talking.
Yes.
Because for me, that was not my reality. So I didn't. When I heard this from her, I was thinking to myself, is she talking about me? How is this possible? And of course, the difference between married life and dating is that one is not constantly under the spotlight while dating, because one always has an avenue to retreat.
Yes.
You date, you drop the person back home, you drop the person back in school, whatever it is. But having to deal with situations
in your face,
absolutely, 24/7, things that you didn't say, things that you didn't mean, things that you didn't imply, as it hits you, it is really, I used to box in university, and I think that's an interesting analogy. It's like being put in the corner and being whacked nonstop. You know, and not everybody has a Muhammad Ali sort of rope-a-dope type expertise to you know, for the other person to literally box themselves to a standstill. But it's a very serious problem. You cannot dictate how your partner feels. And again, that's something one doesn't pick up while dating. One says something, one does something, and the response one gets from one's partner oftentimes is not what one expects. Simply because the partner maybe heard something different.
Yeah.
The partner saw something different. So there was a nuance that the partner picked up that was not at all intended.
Yeah.
And once that starts, it can take the relationship or that situation
in
a totally different trajectory, which can, you know, might not be corrected. And sometimes it's never corrected. And by the time these things start to build up, they can get to a point where you're literally sitting on a volcano about to erupt. And I think for a lot of us, for a lot of married couples, when that eruption takes place, everybody just runs for cover and just digs in their heels and says, you know what, it's your fault. No, it's your fault. And
not owning things, not taking responsibility.
Absolutely.
Just throwing faults here and there.
Yeah, and by the time, of course, family members come into the mix and then friends get into the mix, it's just, it's very, very messy.
Okay, tell me about your time apart. You know, at some point, you had to move out. At some point, the kids were coming in. Tell me about you having to move out. in the midst of all of this?
Well, I won't say that I had to move out. It was a decision I made. Mm. I decided to move out because things were becoming very, very volatile. Let's put it that way.
Couldn't you have gotten help from counselors? Did you speak with counselors, church people? You guys are Christians, right?
We are.
Yeah. Church people. Well, family. There's this thing about family meaning well, but not, you know, family comes into situations like this. They mean well, but it rubs off badly on either you or Funke. Did you get help? Just weave it into you now having to be away.
Well, definitely over the 6.5 years, we went through the whole nine yards. There's nobody we didn't talk to. There's no category of counselors or helpers or advisors that we did not reach out to. But unfortunately, again, looking at it from my own perspective, my biggest mistake was not getting down on my knees and asking God for guidance, asking God for advice, because ultimately, you know, human beings are, you know, obviously have their frailties, have their prejudices, and you're not dealing with somebody who really has all the answers. You're not dealing with someone who's been through it all, who knows one inside out, who knows one's partner inside out. So that was where I definitely made a very big mistake, and I always joke that Funke was sending Scud missiles, spiritual Scud missiles to me in the form of scriptures throughout, even in the early days of the separation, but definitely throughout the 6.5 years that I couldn't make sense of. And after a while, quite frankly, they irritated me to no end, and I actually started to resent them.
So at your point of separation, you still kept in touch, as in with text messages?
We had to, because of the children. Mm. We had to, we tried to maintain a civil relationship, but it didn't work. It wasn't that civil because of the hurt, the pain. But I'd like to go back a little bit and
please.
And you know, very early in the relationship as well, God was no longer the center, you know, of our relationship, and I also think that, in fact, I know that that was really what, that was the end, I would say. So we started relying on our own strength, on our own knowledge and wisdom to guide us through the relationship. So when you asked about, you know, had we tried counseling, did you try church, and I think we felt if we couldn't help
Nobody
could. And it took a while to go back to that place where you recognize that you can't change anybody.
Mm-hmm.
It's better. In fact, it's best you just go to the person's creator
and
you report the person, and you talk it over with God. And then you also need strength, and you need someone bigger than you to open your eyes to see your own fault. And that, I think doing that for me, during the time that we were separated, you know, I said, stop, look, and listen. Looking at, you know, it helped me refocus. It helped me look at, you know, my own contribution, what I contributed to the relationship that made it end up the way it was. We were both happy. We were in love. Why couldn't we just,
you know, I like what you said now. Sorry to cut in. You had to look at what you did to contribute, to bring it to where it was. Mm-hmm. You were owning the fact that, hey, look, part of this is my fault, so let me search myself. You know, someone would probably say, yeah, it's his fault, now he's the man of the house, he should know everything and all of that, you know? That is key.
Well, it took me a while to get there, to be honest with you.
Oh, you got there anyway.
It took me after months, and I think a year and a half of you know, playing the blaming game.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, saying, oh, Chevron ought to know better. Mm-hmm. Again, expectations. You know, life forces you. That's the truth.
Mm-hmm.
Whether it's with an illness, or you lose money, or you're waiting for something, or it's a bad marriage, it forces you to stop. or to pause, and then you begin. So some people will not look. They will not look, they won't do the looking part. They'll just rush into another relationship. So it forced me to take a look at what we had done wrong, what I contributed to the breakdown of communication and our relationship, and then turn it over to God, because I just didn't know what to do anymore. And we had talked to family and people and counselors, and so it forced me to get on my knees. And
how did you handle him being away?
Oh, it was very painful. Like I said, when we got married, I was relatively young, and my whole life really
depended.
It revolved around him, you know. And so I had to get a job. It forced me to get a job, to reach out to friends. So I had you know, and then good people around me, church and all of that. But how did I was miserable. I was devastated. I just never thought that I would call it rejection. That's how I felt, that my husband would say I wasn't good enough after 5 years. Yeah, 5 years of being married.
Wow.
And the interesting thing there again is that those are the same words that I was playing around with in my head, that I was not good enough, that I had done everything, that a woman who was without a shadow of a doubt, I mean, I wasn't playing around, she was the center of my life. And yet I would get the wrong responses, and yet I would love her. I would, as far as I was concerned, I was putting her on a pedestal. But as Fumpes said, from her own perspective,
it was
other people. She was at the back of the queue. And how do you reconcile both? And for me, I think to a large extent, the fact that I was not playing my role as the priest of the house. That's the honest to goodness truth. And obviously because of that, we had not made a conscious decision to say, you know what, this is our family altar. It is sacrosanct. And I was at a church a few weeks ago, and I realized on looking at, there was a sign, there was one of these flexi boards outside the church auditorium that had a list of items, prohibited items that the congregants are not allowed to take into the auditorium, and it includes, you know, obviously weapons and you know, offensive materials, you know, hazardous materials and all that. And it occurred to me that with a family altar, that is how it has to be treated. That when husband and wife, obviously based on a conscious decision, this is our family altar, we're going to devote our lives to God, we're going to give God the pride of place that he deserves. When we go to the altar, when a couple goes to the altar, we should be looking at checking in, depositing outside the family altar all these hazardous
things
materials,
that shouldn't be there.
And it can be anger, it can be, you know, jealousy, it can be, you know, hard unforgiveness, whatever it is. But the minute one takes it to the altar, then the altar is polluted. So it's no longer have that purity of heart that God expects of us, and that our partner expects of us. So again, with the benefit of hindsight, if one could do things all over again, I would say that one would have to carve out that altar and really keep it hallowed and give it the dignity that it deserves.
I'm talking with Segun and Funke Adeniji. They're up here in the men's room. Their story, their life, also known as what I'll call broken and mending. We'll take a quick break, and when we come back, we'll bring you more taking us up the hour. Following, if you're just hooking up, you missed out on a whole lot, but let's see how much you can get right up to the top of the hour. Now, I want to, in the midst of all of this, you still had children. At what point did the kids come out, and how did you make it? Because there you were having difficulties, having challenges, you know, in communicating, in loving yourselves, in being a happy couple and all of that. Yet, I guess the kids came out, yeah? How did that happen? How were you able to balance that?
Well, at the beginning, it wasn't all dislike and hate and resentment, the love was still there.
Mm.
And we would make up.
Make up and make out.
So I guess that answers.
Sorry, this is a family program.
Well, it's all good. It's all good.
So there was the making up bit, and you know, again, love just wasn't enough.
Yeah.
There were things that were not being said. There were things that were being swept under the carpet, and we just didn't know how to deal with those things. We were speaking sometimes and not speaking, but we just were not communicating the wrong language. We would talk, but I think we were just talking above our heads.
You weren't feeling yourselves. There was, emotions were lost in all of that, right? How did the kids take it? You know, in the period where you had the storms, did they know? Was there any form of display in front of them? You know, anger and rage and arguments and all of that. How did they take it, and how did you handle it with them?
When we first separated, they were very young.
You got three kids, by the way.
Yes, the first is now 16, going on 17, 14, and then we've got a six-year-old as well. So then there were just two
16,
boys.
16, 14, and
five
six.
Going on six.
Five going on six. That's like the love child.
Union child, union baby.
Union baby.
So when we first got separated, there were three and one.
Hmm.
So they were pretty young, but you know,
okay.
Growing up, they would, you know, different houses, mom's house, dad's house.
Hmm.
So there came a time that we needed to explain to them
what was happening.
And yes, they did see some of our arguments, and I think that was part of the reason why Shegun felt he needed that. You know, we needed time apart because I would flare up. I would, you know, I would throw tantrums and all of that. And he felt it was better we were apart, that the children wouldn't see all of that and try to sort things out. But I always felt that, you know, we could do it together. But how, I just, you know, we didn't have the right skills at the time.
Mm.
And we didn't bother to even look for the right skills.
Mm.
Yeah, and also I think because the children were so young, I think it's again with the benefit of hindsight, the reason marriage is under such constant attack, by the devil is that if the devil is lucky just once in a home, if there's a little crack and the devil makes his way into that crack, it can affect very quickly. It can affect so many generations, not just husband, not just the couple and their children, but even their parents, because obviously they're going to be sucked into it, as will their siblings. And it can be very, very horrible. It can be very painful, even with the best intentions in the world.
Mm.
Blood is always thicker than water. I mean, when by the time parents get involved and try and, you know, throw in their own their own wisdom, and siblings try and guide one, friends who've been through divorce, it's there's always going to be biases and so on, no matter how well intentioned the
spread. By the spread now, I mean the animosity spreading to the in-laws being outlaws.
Absolutely. And it becomes at a point it definitely became toxic. I mean, radioactive. It was really, really bad. And again, that's where the devil is very wily, because he just needs to get a wedge in that door,
and that's it,
and that role. So and again, by the time one is talking about is playing mind games, I moved out. I decided, you know, there was no point. I couldn't.
At some point, when I got tired of all of that, and they weren't doing me any good, they weren't doing my husband any good, I decided to go back on my knees. And to go back to the source of my strength, and the the one who created marriage and go back with the broken pieces. So I think that was a turning point for me. And I realized early that I couldn't change my husband. I loved him still. So I went back and I prayed about him. I prayed for his soul. I realized that our marriage wasn't as important as him being right with God, as me being right with God. So I think I focused more on that, on developing myself. You know, I focused on my job, on the children, on having healthy friendships, and built a life outside of
him.
Of him.
Mm.
I think that's also important. There should be a balance, and that I think that was what I didn't get right at the beginning.
Mm.
You know, I suffocated him, I think, at the beginning.
Okay.
I think that's...
Shogun?
I definitely went through some very, very dark chapters that... You know, the sort of chapters that one, the sort of experiences that one won't wish on one's enemy. And I realized that pain can be so intense that it can literally make one feel like saying, you know what, I'm done.
Mm.
I'm done. I'm done with marriage. I'm done with trying.
Sometimes I'm done with life.
Sometimes I'm done with life, which is precisely where I'm going. And I always used to listen to... There are a couple of radio stations I used to listen to at night, and I'd listen to callers telling the anchor about how they wanted to end it all, and I never used to understand it. I always used to think that suicidal tendencies were a sign of a sick mind.
Mm.
And it was only later on that I realized, just listening to people and then looking around and then looking at how I felt, looking at some of these dark places that I was at, that suicidal tendency is just it's an unanswered cry for help. It's nothing more than that.
Yeah.
You know, obviously some people, there are some mental issues sometimes, but a lot of the time, people don't know where to turn to. It's just hopelessness. It's helplessness, and people just say, you know, and you know, even you know, to the point where you know one is thinking, okay, I'm going to settle scores, even if I end it all. I'm going to write I'm going to leave a suicide note so that I will absolve myself of of any kind of blame. You'll know how I really felt. Blah blah blah. And again, it's something that can happen so quickly, and it's just the grace of God that keeps everybody on an even keel. But at the same time, what made me snap out of any kind of thoughts about ending it all. Number one, I still loved Funke, in spite of everything. Mm. I loved my children, and I love life. To be honest, and I realized that there was no way. And also, I was smart enough to realize that. Look, if one does anything stupid, one is still going to have to answer to God, and you can't say, one won't be able to say that.
You lose here and lose there.
Mm-hmm. That's more than a double whammy, probably an infinite whammy, So that was one, that was something that sort of made me stand back. And secondly, I went for a program at one of the Pentecostal church, a Holy Ghost night service, and there was an altar call. And I went to the front of the church, and this was after we'd actually been given the interim divorce. And at the time, the day the interim divorce was actually granted, the judge said that she'd be praying for us, that she was really unhappy that she'd have to grant my request since I'd initiated divorce proceedings, but that she'd be praying for us. And next time the two of us were in her court. Our courtroom, we tell her that we'd reconciled and that we'd arranged a really really elaborate holiday in some exotic destination. And it was almost heartbreaking for me to listen to that, because I knew where she was coming from. She obviously had our files in front of her. She'd seen the family photos, the photos of the children, and it was, God bless her soul, she was wishing us well, but there was no way, as far as I was concerned, that it could happen, because by then we'd run the whole gauntlet of
counselors,
you know, different helpers,
family, friends,
church. We even went to England, so it's, you know, on some top-notch specialist. When I think about how much that psychologists, and but the missing link in the whole thing, certainly, again, stressing from my own perspective, the missing link in the whole thing was God. Because even when one was talking to friends and, you know, family, those who said stay, those who said go, nobody said stay or go because of, you know, there was no scriptural basis.
Mm.
So it was all based on personal opinion. And, you know, that if it's not God's way, it's the wrong way, no matter what, you know, what one says, no matter where one is coming from. So that was, you know, so that was that. So at the Holy Ghost night, I basically, during the altar call, I basically lay down on my stomach. I started to cry. And, you know, I was literally flat out on the floor. And by the time I stood up and I looked around me, I was surrounded by people who'd also answered the altar call. And there were those who had put down different ties to their, just things that tied them to their past. They were, whether they were, you know, weapons and amulets and this, that, and the other. And that was, for me, my own, the most graphic, the most poignant spiritual encounter I've ever had in my life, because I knew that I was in God's house, I knew I was in God's presence, but I knew, just looking at those items on the floor, that those were the devil's deposits. Those are the ways, those are some of the ways through which the devil controls people. And those are some of the, sort of, a, you know, the alluring devices that the devil uses in order to draw people in. And I know that the devil will definitely give people, offer people shortcuts, whether it's to get a partner, whether it's to keep a partner, whether it's to get rid of a competitor, whether it's to do well in business. Mm. But obviously, one always has to read the small print, because there's the, you know, the payback is always very it's very costly. But I also realized that I couldn't change myself. You know, I realized that it was a question of a choice. God was basically showing me that you can choose light, the path of light, you can choose the path of darkness. And and also that in terms of my marriage, that I was trying to influence, or I was trying to change Funke, but that I can't even change myself without the grace of God. It was there at the altar I realized it for the first time. And that the best way to make my marriage work, to heal the marriage, to heal myself, repair the relationship, was to focus inwards, try and change myself. And Funke would see that, and that would prompt her to try and see, change herself, as opposed to, you know, trying to impose it. So something so simple, I realized there and then at that altar. And that's what that's what made me realize that it was not the marriage was not over. So obviously from there, I now went back to Funke and tried to convince her that we could actually make this thing work. But by then, I think she was, if she had an exorcist, she would have told the person to die.
Wow.
But so that's how we started the, you know, the process of trying to of reconciling.
Mm.
And, you know, thank God it had a happy ending. And eventually, she cares, gradually she lowered her defenses after the initial and understandable skepticism. But eventually it clicked.
I'm happy for you guys. I am happy because, I mean, not too many people have the same story that you have, or have this story of happy ending and all of that. And it's a process. Yes, you've overcome this. I'm not saying this will come, but you'll also have other challenges that will come your way. But the fact that you've been able to overcome this major one will be like, those other ones would be like a walk in the park.
Yeah, we expect, again, we were even discussing it the other day, you hit the nail on the head. There's anybody, even Christians, no matter how much one knows, no matter what one has gone through, one takes one's eyes off the road at one's peril.
Mm.
The devil does not sleep.
Mm. That's what he's looking for.
He's just waiting for one to lower one's guard, and then in he comes. So one absolutely must never ever think that one knows it all, one's done it all, God is on my side, I love God, I worship. There's no, And that's why the Bible says that we always have to, we must always watch and pray, because the devil is always on the lookout, and he literally sifts people like wheat, because he knows where our Achilles tendons are. And it's just a question of the right time, right method in order to reel us in.
And so, I also think it's also important that the self-assessment is continuous.
Mm.
One, you must never get to a point where you feel, oh, you've arrived, and because you overcame challenges or certain difficult situations together, nothing else can shake you, shake that foundation. As long as it's anchored on God, you've learned lessons from where you're coming from, and you continue to keep that open, honest relationship. And you know, it's easier now. I mean, to talk. We talk more than we did when we were together the first time as husband and wife. So it's important that you just keep assessing, and then you trust each other as well. It's okay for me to say something to Shego and he doesn't feel exactly the wrong way. Mm. It's important that he knows that I've got his back and he's got mine.
Mm.
Because all of that has been tried and tested over the years. So.
And you're solid as a rock.
Big amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
I don't know what you got from this. You've been listening. I don't know what you got, but for me, like I did say when I started, in life, you're either that there is a higher power that has got your back and would be able to help you through whatever it is. Now, we all know that marriages go through a whole lot of crazy times and crazy situations right here, right now. I mean, the economy, all kinds of things just come in and just give that different angle and meaning to marriage, but like you've heard, they made it through the thick and thin and crazy times. That can be your story. I just thought you should listen to them, hear them out, and see what you can pick from here, from their own story, and make it your reality. And in preparing to get married, and in being getting, or in your state of being married, yeah. Thank you so much for coming. I really appreciate it. And all it took was a phone call. I called them, and that was it. Then we followed up with text messages, and thank you for coming.
Thank you for having us.
I really appreciate it, and we look forward to having you more in the men's room. This is not it. I'm going to be calling you guys subsequently, whenever the need arises. This is a story that should be heard over and over and over again, just to give people hope that yes, it can get crazy, it can get ugly, it can get stormy, but just realize that it can also have a happy ending. Just depends on how you play the ball. It's a men's room. I'm Onimisi Adaba. If you enjoyed it, let's carry on the chat on Twitter at men's room NG. Yeah. Drop by there and see how you can contribute whatever you can contribute. And just follow us on Twitter and be part of it. Yeah? All right, till next time, over and out. That's it.